Good morning, everybody. Yesterday was a record of 110,000 people in New South Wales who got the jab, who were vaccinated. And that is a phenomenal outcome. And I encourage everybody to please come forward and get vaccinated. To date, we have 5.5 million jabs that we've given in New South Wales. 53% of our population has had at least one dose, and 28% of us are fully vaccinated. And obviously, we want to see these numbers climb as quickly as possible. So thank you to everybody coming forward to getting vaccinated. In the last 24 hours, we had 119,000 people come forward to get testing. We had 681 cases of community transmission, with 59 at least infectious in the community during that time. And we extend our sympathies and condolences to the family of a man in his 80s who died at St George Hospital in the last 24 hours. He'd had one dose of the vaccine and did have underlying health conditions. And we extend our deepest sympathies deceased man and to the family of that deceased man. In relation to the areas that remain a concern, Western Sydney and southwestern Sydney are generating the vast majority of our cases, and I'll go through the suburbs of concern, but we also have with us today Commissioner Shane Fitzsimmons from Resilience New South Wales, who has been working closely with government and non-government organisations in those communities to make sure that people are well supported and make sure they have every opportunity to stay within the rules in relation to the virus. In relation to the suburbs of most concern, Merrylands, Guildford, Auburn, Granville, Lidcombe, Greenacre and Blacktown are the suburbs that Health wants us to call out today. They are the areas where there's the fastest growth in cases. It doesn't mean there aren't other areas that we're concerned about, but they are the main ones. And we ask everybody in those communities to assume, first of all, you should be staying at home, but assume the second you put foot outside your door that you have the virus or anybody you're coming into contact with has the virus. In Western New South Wales, we remain concerned with the cases bubbling along, especially around Wilcannia and Dubbo, and the Deputy Premier will give an update on what is happening in the regions. Things are settling down in other parts of regional New South Wales, which is positive, but obviously our concerns remain about Western New South Wales in particular. I also want to announce, and the Deputy Premier will reinforce this as well, that given the outbreak in Western New South Wales and a few cases elsewhere throughout the regions, that the lockdown in regional New South Wales will align with the rest of New South Wales. So until at least the 28th of August, all of regional New South Wales will also remain in lockdown as a precaution. We know that there are vast areas of regional New South Wales where there aren't any cases, but everybody would appreciate and expect us to take a precautionary response, given we have the opportunity to get down to zero cases in the regions. That's certainly what we want to achieve, and therefore we're taking that precautionary response. As I mentioned at the outset, New South Wales is already up to 5.5 million jabs, and once we get to 6 million jabs, those that are vaccinated will have the opportunity to be able to do something they can't do now. And I really want to stress how pleased I am with the number of people that have responded to vaccines and coming forward. And I want to remind the people of this state that once we get to the end of October, we expect 70% of our population to be fully vaccinated. And once we get to mid-November, we expect 80% of our population to be fully vaccinated. And that gives us enormous opportunities to have greater freedoms than we do today. I also wanted to encourage again anybody between the ages of 16 and 39 who lives in those local government areas of concern throughout Western Sydney and southwestern Sydney, please come forward and get vaccinated. The federal government gave us 500,000 extra doses of Pfizer, and we have 2.5 weeks to get it out to everybody. So please come forward, go online and book. You'll be given priority. We know that age group in particular are the ones that are having to work, the ones that kind of are the conduit between generations. And we know that around 3/4 of all cases in those areas of concern are people under the age of 40. And for that reason, we're really focusing on those rates. I know these are challenging times, but I also can see the light at the end of the tunnel. These are difficult times for all of us, and the next few weeks will be hard. But know that once we hit those high vaccination rates, life will feel much better. Life will look much rosier. And I appreciate what we're going through is difficult, but every state in Australia will have to come to terms with the fact that when you get to a certain level of vaccination and start opening up, Delta will creep in. We can't pretend that we're going to be zero cases around Australia of Delta. As the Doherty report says, once you get to 80% double doses and you have to open up, everybody's going to have to learn to live with Delta. Admittedly, in New South Wales, we're learning that earlier than others. But having said that, what I'm absolutely convinced about is New South Wales can lead the way in making sure we keep people out of hospital, reducing the deaths, and making sure that we provide our citizens the opportunity to live as freely and as safely as possible. And whilst every single death is a horrendous tragedy, what we need to ensure is that through high rates of vaccination, if we keep people out of hospital, we keep people out of intensive care, we stop people dying, that means we're starting to live with COVID. But I want to manage those comments with the fact that everything we need to throw at reducing the case numbers. So whilst the high vaccination rates gives us those opportunities to live more freely, it is not in any way a comment that we shouldn't get the case numbers down. We absolutely need to. We need to turn the corner. And that's why we look at every opportunity we have, especially in those areas of concern, of what more we can do. And Commissioner Fitzsimmons will speak about that as well. So now I'll ask Dr. Marianne Gow to give the health update. Deputy Premier will talk about regional New South Wales. Deputy Commissioner Warboys will talk about police compliance activity. And Commissioner Fitzsimmons will talk about our activity in those areas of concern. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier, and good morning, everybody. There were 681 locally acquired cases of COVID-19 reported in the 24 hours till 8 p.m. last night. There were 3 overseas cases also reported to 8 p.m. last night. As the Premier said, we had almost 120,000 tests done until 8 p.m. last night. And again, a big thank you to the people of New South Wales for heeding that message around coming forward for testing very promptly if you have even the mildest of symptoms. In hospital, there are currently 474 cases. 82 of those cases are in intensive care, and 25 cases are currently requiring ventilation. Of the 82 cases who are in ICU, 71 are not vaccinated. Sadly, New South Wales Health has been notified of the death of one person who had COVID-19 till 8 p.m. last night, and that is a man in his 80s from southeastern Sydney. He died at St George Hospital. He had received one dose of vaccine and was also being treated for another serious medical condition. And as the Premier has extended her sympathies, I'd also like to extend my sympathies on behalf of New South Wales Health to the family of that man who passed away. This brings the number of COVID-related deaths in the pandemic to 117 so far, and 61 deaths since June 16th. I'd like to provide a bit more of an update around the situation in Western New South Wales, which, as the Premier said, is deeply concerning to us. There have been 25 new cases of COVID-19 reported till 8 p.m. last night in Western New South Wales, and that brings the total in the local health district to 167. We do ask all the people, all the population of Western New South Wales to really be very vigilant for symptoms, to come forward for testing, as I know that many people have already done, and please take up any opportunity to get vaccinated as soon as you can. We are concerned about 3 cases overnight notified in Wilcannia. Those cases are going to be included in tomorrow's numbers. And we are very concerned about the risk of community transmission in Wilcannia, and we call on anyone who has been in or near Wilcannia in recent days to please get tested. In the Hunter New England area, there are 5 cases, and bringing the total cases in the LHD to 150 since early August. I'm pleased that all 5 of those cases in Hunter New England are linked, which is good news. In terms of sewage detections, we have had sewage detections in a couple of areas where there are no known cases currently, and that is in Foster, in Batow Bay and also in Yamba. So I do encourage the populations of those areas to please come forward for testing as soon as you can. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Can I also start by offering my sincere condolences to the family and friends of the loved one that was lost overnight, and you remain in our prayers and in our thoughts. As the Premier touched on, the New South Wales Government, the Crisis Committee made a decision overnight to extend a lockdown for regional and rural New South Wales for an additional 7 days, or to align it to the 28th of August timeline in line with Greater Sydney. The decision for that was based on the numbers that we've just heard. Numbers like in Western New South Wales, 25 new cases overnight, and they were spread in areas like Bathurst had a case, Brewarrina 2 cases, Dubbo 20 cases, and Mudgee 2 cases, taking the total new cases, or the total cases in that area, active cases, to 167. Cases in the Central Coast, one in Gosford, 5 cases in Newcastle. There was a case in southern New South Wales yesterday reported in Goulburn, and on the mid-north coast, South Kempsey, a case. Since the 8 p.m. reporting period overnight, we know that we've got more cases in Western New South Wales, in Southern New South Wales, Hunter, New England, and the Central Coast. So therefore, it's starting to show clearly that there are still concerns in regional and rural New South Wales. We know of this morning, there are now 2 new cases in Queanbeyan. And of course, we know that the escalating crisis that is occurring in Canberra is causing that surround, like Goulburn and Queanbeyan, issues. And that's why we've got to continue to be very worried about the regions. Sewage surveillance in Batow Bay, Foster and Yamba, on top of the sewage surveillance that we've seen in previous days, has always given us a level of concern. And that is why it is right that we stay in front of the curve, that we stay in front of the spread, and we keep regional and rural New South Wales in lockdown. And my message to everybody continues to be to make sure we stay vigilant, to get out and get tested if you have symptoms. Those extra 3 cases overnight in Wilcannia continue to be worrying as we see an escalation of cases in that region. And for Western New South Wales, the far west, and now southern parts of New South Wales, really means get tested if you're not feeling well. And of course, my message is always get vaccinated. And we've got AstraZeneca and Pfizer available across the state in many access points in regional and rural New South Wales. So get online, book in, and get vaccinated. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier. Good morning, everyone. 671 penalty infringement notices issued right across New South Wales in the last 24 hours. Of note, 393 of those were issued to people who were out of their home or their residence without a reasonable excuse, which is terribly concerning when you think about the messaging every day here and through the media around people staying at home and not leaving home unless it's for those essential reasons. So 393 people in the last 24 hours detected by police out and about, and some of those examples, a group of young men at Smithfield who decided to set up a soccer field and go about playing soccer. They were spoken to by police. They absolutely knew that they were doing the wrong thing. They were issued with infringement notices and told to go back to their residence. And another example is a man who travelled from Bondi to southwest Sydney. The fourth time that police have spoken to this man, and of course, his time's up. He was arrested. He was taken to the police station. He was charged with that offence, and he was bail refused and will be put before the courts. So here is a person that on 4 occasions just blatantly disregards the public health order. And both of these incidents, it's not just about the person themselves, it's about their family, it's about their community, it's about people who openly go outside the orders and put everyone at risk and continue to keep us in this lockdown situation longer than what we might normally do. I'd also like to reassure people that up at Newcastle already, the Australian Defence Force is working with police. Nearly 400 people visited up there yesterday. Those people who were meant to be isolating or meant to be quarantining in their home, they were visited by ADF and police. And of course, today we have ADF on the ground at Dubbo to work with police out there in relation to people who should be staying at home in terms of the directions by health. those ADF arrangements at Newcastle and also particularly out at Dubbo will be shared across those areas of greatest need or where we think we can get the best results in terms of contact tracing and making sure those people remain isolated from the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Premier. Deputy, the crisis is extraordinary and no more than in some of those focus areas of the Sydney Basin, the focus LGAs of Sydney Basin. And I just want to do a big shout out today to say a sincere thank you. The overwhelming majority of individuals, of families, of businesses, of community leaders have been working with and in conjunction with government and non-government organisation, providing guidance and assistance and the necessary details to ensure that we make provisions and assistance and supports available to those that need it most, and importantly, to seek to suppress the spread throughout these communities. They're focus LGAs for a reason. The complexity and the challenges cannot be overstated, but through extraordinary partnerships across government, Multicultural New South Wales, Customer Service, Health, Police and Emergency Services, an extraordinary array of organisations across the state government, through our Commonwealth partners, Services Australia, through Health and ADF and others, but importantly, through local MPs, local councillors, local mayors, local governments, general managers, and our community partner organisations, organisations like the Red Cross, Salvation Army, health and mental health services and support services, you name them, we've been in this together. And taking the guidance and the assistance means that we've been able to focus in a number of key areas around the nuance that's needed to accommodate the challenges and the circumstances that we rely on as a broader population to have viable operations occurring in these focus LGAs. Whether that be focuses around vaccinations and options for increasing vaccination rates, testing options and testing arrangements to ensure we get increased testing, surveillance testing, symptomatic testing, testing and isolating away from work, supports for community-led organisations and initiatives, partnering with local community leaders, religious leaders, business leaders, our elected leaders, all those leaders coming together to support one another and provide assistance and guidance on what works best is resulting in change, is resulting in improvement. Support and payments to businesses to help them be compliant, to help them have safer operating venues and limiting the mobility throughout those areas. It's been an extraordinary effort. And what we don't understand too often is that increasingly we learn that with the complexities and challenges and the extraordinary high proportion of infections rates throughout these communities, and we can't ignore the fact that we still see 80-85% of our daily cases centering around the focus LGAs. What we've also got to realise is that we are also critically dependent on the extraordinary men and women throughout these focus LGAs to keep us going. We identify that some of our transport services, some of our environment and waste services, our food distribution networks and our distribution centres and our goods getting out into supermarkets that we need and we rely on, you're talking 60, 70, 80% of the frontline critical workers are in these focus LGAs. So having a nuanced approach, a partnership that extends all levels of government and in particular community organisation is yielding benefit. We've got a long way to go, there's no doubt about it, but the inroads are being made and we're seeing that local approach, that engagement right across the emergency management arrangements here in New South Wales, extending out to provide the nuanced support and assistance that's critical to some of our more vulnerable and at-risk communities right across rural and regional areas of the state. So my message today is a sincere thank you to all the partnering, all the support, and particularly those communities. The overwhelming majority of who, 99% of people, individuals, families, businesses, are doing the right thing. We will continue the focus through Mr. Warboys and the team on compliance, but we can't lose sight of the fact that everyone is doing their part as much as they can. The lockdowns, the limitations, the restrictions, the conditions that we face are challenging. There is no doubt about that. And there's no point dancing around the narrative. It's problematic, it's challenging, and I don't support the phrase social distancing. As a matter of fact, what we're talking about is physical distancing. Now in these tough times, more than ever, we need to be socially connected. We need to be reaching out, checking in on one another. making sure that we're looking after our own welfare and that of our loved ones, our families and our networks. But we do it virtually. We need to maintain the physical distance. We need to stay at home. We need to follow the rules. But now more than ever, we need to reach out and support one another. That text message, that phone call, that video chat, they are so important. And right now, we need to lift our spirits. We need to focus on the fact that we will get through this awful time, but we'll do it together, and we'll do it through looking out for each other and accessing and utilising the supports and services that are available. We'll give you the assurance that our efforts are resulting in extraordinary distribution of goods and materials and support and care services. Just in the last few weeks, last couple of months, something like 1,600 tonnes of food products in hampers, of personal care packs, the basic things around sanitary products and all those sorts of things are being distributed to those that need it most. Yes, there's been an extraordinary high proportion in focus LGAs, but it's also occurring right across the state. We'll continue to do that proactively and for those in need. Reach out through your local community organisations, reach out through your local council. We'll continue to partner with health and particularly support those that are forced into isolation for positive cases, but also there's access points through our Service New South Wales website. We will get through this together, and we want to make sure that people know the support and assistance is out there, and we're ready to provide that as and where is needed. Thank you.
Premier.